Good morning and welcome to the 27th meeting in 2023 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. And I just want to note that both Mark Griffin and Stephanie Callaghan are joining us online. And I would also like to invite Marie McNair and Stephanie to draw attention to their interests. Marie.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to declare that up until May 2022, I was a councillor in Western Bartonshire.
Thank you. And Stephanie.
Sorry, Convener. I think you can hear me now.
Yep.
Thank you. Yes, just to declare that I was a councillor at South Lanarkshire Council up until 2021. Thank you.
Thanks. And may I remind members and witnesses to ensure that all their devices are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item on the agenda today is to decide whether to take item 6 in private. Are members agreed? We're all agreed. The committee previously agreed to take item 5 in private. The next item on our agenda today is to take evidence on the Visitor Levy Scotland Bill from two panels of witnesses. And we're joined on our first panel online by Miriam Kelly, who's the Chief Officer of Local Government Finance, and Councillor Gail McGregor, who's the Environment and Economy Spokesperson at COSLA. And I welcome our witnesses to the meeting. And we will direct our questions in the first instance to Councillor McGregor. But Miriam, if you'd like to come in, please type R in the chat function. There's no need for you to manually operate your microphones, as we'll do that automatically for you. And I'll start off, I think we're around a theme of your views of the general aims of the bill. So COSLA's submission on the levy said that it would have a positive impact on local government. And I'd be interested to hear from you what your thoughts are around the fact that not all local authorities are expected to introduce a levy, and also if you have thoughts around if that will create a funding disparity between councils that have high numbers of overnight visitors with those that have relatively few.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, members. It's lovely to be here. Just to give a bit of context, I launched the consultation on this in June 2018, so it's been in the system for quite a long time now, and it's great that we've got to this stage. We've been very clear as COSLA that this is not a one-size-fits-all, that not all local authorities will use power. We do have some authorities who are heavily pressured with high tourist numbers and high visitor numbers. For them, it will be absolutely pivotal to be able to manage the services that are required around that tourist offering. So I think it's critical that all the public, the businesses out there, understand that this is not going to be implemented across all authorities. It will be very sensitively handled by those who feel that they need to introduce that power to manage the services. And obviously, the additional income that is intended to come in from the visitor levy will be utilised to support those tourism and visitor services. I don't know if Miriam has anything to add.
Thanks for that. I just wonder, though, around the disparity piece, around some local authorities taking up the levy and others not, in terms of the funding disparities. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, I think, as I've just said, the key for this is that the additional income that will come in from the visitor levy will be utilised to support high levels of visitor numbers and the services right. That are required around that. So authorities that don't have as high visitor numbers will not have the additional service pressures. Right. So the money will go back into services.
OK, thanks for clarifying that. I didn't quite pick you up there. And kind of continuing on that theme around tourist offers and tourist pressures, in your submission, you mentioned that there's significant local authority reduction in spending on culture, leisure and roads over the past 10 years. And I'd be interested to understand if COSLA's done any research on what impact spending decisions have had on the tourist offer and on those communities impacted, and to what extent could the visitor levy money help reverse any underinvestment in these service areas?
example, as you'll be aware, local government finance and has reduced, in particularly in areas that are not ring fenced or protected. So your culture and leisure services, your environmental services and roads have been particularly hit in the last 10, 13 years. So I think the key here is that the visitor levy, as I say, where there's additional pressure on service and particular authorities, will be used directly to support the very things like your waste collection, your street scene, your offering that makes it a more attractive place for people to visit. Now, these areas, as we know, have been cut consistently over the years, and you know, to very much protect frontline services and key services. But when you're looking at offering a good tourist offering or a good visitor offering, those services are really important. As I say, your street scene, ensuring that your environment is clean, that waste is lifted promptly. If you don't have the funding to do that and you have high visitor numbers, then the offering becomes less. So I think the key with this is that the additional funding that will come in will assist in that support. Mirren may have some additional mapping around the impact of that, but certainly those particular services that sit within the 30% of council's budgets that are not protected have been significantly hit in comparison to others.
Thanks. And I'm going to bring in Pam Goso with a brief supplementary.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Councillor Gale, you've just spoken about how the funding may assist basically certain infrastructure and certain clean-up bins and things like that. I raised a question last week and the week before in relation to the revenue that it could end up being used to plug a hole in the council budget. It's a very grey area. And should you think the actual revenue should be ring-fenced for tourist-related spend only? And how do you see that working?
The principle is that local government and individual councils should be able to create a model that suits their particular local area. But there's been a huge emphasis on this being able to assist in areas that are pressured, particularly Edinburgh, Highlands and Islands, Argyll and Bute, where they do see massive visitor numbers and they don't have any additional income at the moment to assist with the pressures of that service. So I think the intention would be in councils to very much direct this funding to areas that would assist tourism. It's not to plug a gap that exists, although there are massive gaps in local government finance. It's to acknowledge that in areas where there are high visitor numbers, then there are higher pressures. And as a consequence of that, the funding would be put back into services that would support that and actually support the business and the communities that live within those areas. We all know that communities can get frustrated when there's high tourist numbers and visitor numbers. They can see that the pressures in their local community can begin to grow and grow. And I think communities would welcome that additional investment that will come on the back of the visitor levy.
Thanks very much for that. And Mirren, you've indicated you wanted to come in.
Thanks, Convener. Just to pick up a couple of those points there. I think on the concern about the potential disparity issue, that's one of the reasons why it's critical that this is discretionary. And following sort of local consultation, councils will then be able to make a decision about whether or not this is the appropriate approach for their local area and their local circumstances. On other elements, Councillor McGregor's obviously clearly sort of setting out that where we see potential benefits here. And I think it's worth highlighting that things like your culture and tourism offer are the ones that have had to be significantly cut in real terms over the past 10 to 15 years due to the directed spend and ring fencing around other elements of the local government funding. And I think that from our perspective and from local authorities that are interested in developing this, the big opportunity this presents is the ability to actually start investing again in the tourism. And I would highlight we're keen to ensure that business tourists as well as leisure tourists are captured within that. But also the benefits that can then, you know, be mutually beneficial to communities who have seen things like reduced investment in their local parks, in their local theatres, in all of that element, which is part of what makes Scotland attractive.
Thank you very much for that additional comments. I'm now going to bring in Marie McNair.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Councillor McGregor and Ms Kelly. I've kind of asked similar questions in the two previous evidence sessions. I wanted to ask, you know, COSLA, and what are your views on this being an accommodation levy rather than a visitor levy? As many kind of visitors such as day trippers, wild campers and some motorhome drivers will pay nothing.
Councillor McGregor.
Thank you. Yes, very good question. I think that the key thing is that it has to be manageable by the local authorities and by the businesses. And as you will appreciate, whether we're looking at a flat rate or a percentage rate, if it's accommodation-based rather than visitor number-based, then it's much easier to manage and collect, and it's easier for the business as well. We have looked at wild campers and motorhomes and the such like, but unless they're actually staying in dedicated sites, it would be very, very difficult for us and probably quite onerous, and get to a point where what we're bringing in through the levy is being lost in the collection of that. So there's been a lot of work done around cruise ships and other areas, but the main and key point is that we need to make it as easy as possible for the businesses to manage and also for the local authority to manage. The full value of that levy does come into the community and then is redistributed through services.
Miriam, you wanted to come in.
Yeah, thank you. And just to add to that, Councillor McGregor is entirely correct. I think you're aware that there is some work in terms of the potential options around cruise liners and what that might mean. We do have there are concerns that we're discussing about, particularly around motorhomes, because what we also wouldn't want to see is any unintended consequences from this that might drive different types of behaviour. So there are conversations around that. And I think that's something that we would be hoping to learn from and actively manage. But Councillor McGregor's point is it does need to be a proportionate and appropriate approach to this. So.
Thank you for that. Just back on cruise ships, obviously, with the Scottish Government confirming the seat to amend the bill, can you give us your views on that?
It's certainly something that COSLA leaders are seeking to have, again, on a discretionary level, to include with it either within this or an appropriate legislative vehicle. We are looking at what that means, this in practice for both local authorities and for industry, and the impact that that could have. It's obviously, you know, not always straightforward as.
Thank you.
Thanks very much, Marie. I'm now going to bring in Pam Gosol.
Thank you, Convener. My question's around obviously. How the levy is raised. I know that Councillor Gale just mentioned there in relation to that flat rates are much easier to manage and collect, and also they're easier for business to manage and local authorities. So my question is really around basically we've had mixed opinions on this, that it should be a percent or it should be a flat rate. And obviously, like you've mentioned, Councillor Gale, that there's burdens on businesses to collect that as well. So should the bill be amended to allow local authorities to introduce flat rates if they decide that's most appropriate for this area? So a question for Councillor Gale first.
Yeah, I think as much flexibility around the model that is used is required. And obviously local councils are looking for that autonomy to implement it in the best way for their particular local area. There's definitely pros and cons. As you can imagine, if we apply a flat rate of £1.50 a night, that has a disproportionate effect on a small bed and breakfast in comparison to a very expensive hotel. So, you know, there are pros and cons on the flat rate. The percentage rate will obviously be slightly more complicated to collect, particularly for accommodation providers that use various booking apps online, so their rates fluctuate. So I think we're looking at the pros and cons and really looking at as much flexibility around the councils being able to operate that, and that's certainly in discussion. And I have to say that this particular bill and the route to this bill has been a good example of really good communication and co-production between the local government and Scottish Government and partners and businesses. And there's been lots of conversations to try and get it right. But at this particular stage, I think local authorities don't have a view either way. It's around looking at what will be the most straightforward for the councils and the businesses to manage that isn't disproportionate and doesn't disadvantage either.
Does Mary want to come? Can I just clarify there, Councillor McGregor? I understand what you're saying around councils wanting to have as much flexibility around the model. But what we've heard from other people coming in to talk to us about this is that it needs, however, it needs to be one or the other, a national agreement, whether it's a flat rate or a percentage.
Yeah, we're not reinventing the wheel here. I think we're one of only 9 countries in Europe that don't have some form of visitor levy. So there's countries and models right across Europe that some implement the percentage rate, some implement a flexible flat rate. In some areas, they do both. I think Amsterdam has a model where they can choose to do one or the other. And I think, crucially, it's having that flexibility and be aware of the potential complications for businesses as well. So, you know, in collaboration and consultation with business, which is going to be absolutely imperative, councils, you know, the individual councils that do decide to take this visitor levy forward, they're going to be expected to do a comprehensive consultation with their local businesses and people that will be affected by the levy. And I think at that stage, then, it needs to be in discussion which will be the best model for that particular local authority area.
I see. So, again, I'm just really trying to get clear here. So you would like to see the bill have the option for a flat rate or a percentage in it, and then allow councils to choose whichever one they want to pick up and consult on?
I think that would be the discussion that we would be having with government, is just to ensure as much flexibility, because, as I say, different areas will want to implement it in different ways to suit that locality. And we do have this model on the continent where, you know, there is that flexibility of percentage model or flat rate.
Thanks very much. And I'm going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Thanks for both joining us today. I wanted to carry on with a couple of questions around that and flexibility, because there has been calls for a national set cap with regards to a percentage rate or the number of nights which would be chargeable. And for that to be set by different local authorities, then would maybe create a postcode lottery across the country when people are coming to visit Scotland. So just wondered what Cosla's view was on that, specifically around the number of nights this would be charged.
Again, you know, it's around the local flexibility of the council, and I think it should be very much self-regulating and that there would be no need for a cap. And I would hope that authorities would look at that very sensitively, understand their local area and the pressures in their local area, if they choose to implement it at all. And having that sort of self-regulating, as I say, no need for a cap would probably be a better model, and that would be Cosla's preferred option.
Okay, thank you for that. Throughout the time we've been looking at this, I've raised the issue of exemptions for individuals, and the fact that this is more accommodation tax than a tourist tax, essentially. And for those groups who are staying in hotels, for example, visiting family members in hospital, not being captured under this. So just wondered, in Cosla's view, firstly, do you support exemptions to this? And then secondly, how you think that could be best delivered? The bill contains a section around voucher schemes, but that's the only detail Scottish Government have really put forward.
Yeah, I think any shift to national exemption would likely create an additional restrictive and sort of disadvantageous burden and would be very difficult to implement. Miriam may be able to speak more to what discussions have happened with government, but as I say, I think trying to avoid the unintended negative consequences could, by contrast, end up with us having an additional burden on councils and businesses for the collection, and then it would be very difficult to collect it, audit and validate the levy and ensure that the exemption is correct. But Miriam, you may have some additional information.
Thanks very much. Just to say, the issue of exemptions is one that we're very aware of, and there will be conversations about whether or not there are either exemptions that local authorities think, you know, consistently should apply, or other elements. But as Councillor McGregor said, we're also very aware of the potential complications that introduces, not just for local authorities, but for businesses and users of these premises themselves. So there is absolutely that balance to be struck between not introducing any unintended consequences or perverse behaviour into markets and reflecting on what the local needs, etc., are. So.
Thank you for that. I suppose the difficulty is most of this is not within local government. It's people booking accommodation online or through the hotels or B&Bs, guest houses they're staying with. So it's not really a role necessarily councils will be responsible for. So I think as the bill progresses, there's maybe more conversation over that. But thank you. Thanks.
Thanks. And I'm now going to bring in Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to you both. I wanted to start, Gail, if I may, asking you what's Causeless views on the 18-month lead-in debate. You've probably heard the variety of evidence at the committee if you've had a chance to see it over previous weeks. Rob Dixon from Visit Scotland was quite passionate, I think, about needing the 18-month lead-in so that the councils are ready, fully ready after their consultation to implement it. But Causeless, you think it can be done a bit sooner than that. Could you just give us a flavour of what Causeless view is about the lead-in period, please?
Yeah, again, you know, we're listening to business and we're trying to work with business to get an implementation model that will work. I think Causeless feels at the moment that the length of the lead-in period of 18 months would be excessive. We do have, obviously, constrained finances, and any, you know, immediate revenue raising would be welcomed by those authorities who are particularly impacted by high visitor numbers and tourism. So I think the 18-month lead-in is particularly excessive, particularly given that we do have experience from many other European cities and countries and municipalities of an implementation model. So, as I say, it's not as if we're creating anything new. Models are out there that can be very easily replicated.
I mean, you said yourself, Gail, that you yourself launched the consultation in 2018, which is now 5 years ago. But I mean, would you be able to put some kind of figure about what Causeless would be happy with in terms of a lead-in at all? I know that's maybe a bit difficult to, unfair to ask you that, but is there any thinking about what is a reasonable period lead-in time for this?
Again, I think it will be down to each individual local authority to look at what model can be implemented. And that would, again, be through consultation. There are a number of authorities, as you know, that are particularly keen to have this implemented. And as you say, we are 5.5 years down the line, notwithstanding that we did have COVID. So I think we can forgive a bit of a delay in the bill. But there are some local authorities that are very keen to get this up and running as quickly as possible. You're sitting in one of the biggest champions, Edinburgh City, are desperate to implement this. So I think as quickly as possible. I don't have a time frame. I don't know if Mirren has had that conversation with Edinburgh City or Highlands and Islands, but certainly they would be very quick to get it up and running.
Thanks very much, Gail. Mirren, did you want to come in on this question?
Yeah, thanks for that. We don't have a formal time frame sort of that's been asked for, but I get to emphasise the reason why we think that 18 months is excessive is because it's 18 months after all of the consultation has been completed. The consultation itself will take several months as local authorities engage with local communities and businesses to kind of develop that. So it's always going to be significantly longer than 18 months before anything is implemented. And that's why we think that an 18-month lead-in is excessive, and that should be reduced. We do appreciate that there is a level, businesses will require some certainty, as do visitors. People plan holidays. So that would have to be sort of considered in terms of how far ahead you would want to provide the certainty to both visitors and businesses.
Okay, thanks very much for that, Mirren. On the issue of the financial memorandum and the BRIA, you probably also heard some conversation about that at the previous committee sessions. Have you a view on whether the memorandum and the BRIA are still appropriate or need to be updated, revised, because they were prepared some years ago? Councillor McGregor.
Sorry, just waiting to be unmuted there. I think it's generally appropriate. It was done in 2019 and it may be a little bit out of date, but the key thing, as I've already said, is that communication, ongoing communication with business and engagement with the industry has continued and will continue. And the key now going forward around any further impact assessments is that they will be done locally within the local council area that is going to implement the levy. And we've been very clear about that continual consultation before implementation with a very robust impact assessment will be absolutely necessary in each individual local authority area.
Thank you very much. Any view on that, Mirren? You were mute there, but I think you said no.
Nothing to add.
Final query from me, perhaps, again to you, Councillor McGregor. We're talking about flexibility all throughout this discussion and debate, and some folks say it's localism for localism's sake, but some folks say it's really important that local authorities have the powers and the flexibility to do things that best suit local circumstances. What does COSLA think themselves about the application of flexibility through this? Should there be rigid rules and guidance, or should there be as much localism as we can possibly put into this system?
Well, it'll come as no surprise to you that as a champion of local government, I'll be looking for as much flexibility around the development and the implementation of the bill as possible. And as I say, this has been in the offing for... It was one of the first ones that we looked at that would provide local government with the flexibility to income generate and bring in some additional funding. And we're consistently being challenged by the government and your committee and various other committees to look at creative ways that we can actually bring in additional income. This one's appropriate because it gives each individual authority, if they choose to, the ability to do that. So, as I say, it'll come as no surprise that we would seek as much flexibility. We know our local areas and what our local areas can manage better. I would suggest that the most... And having that flexibility will ensure that the model is right for that particular locality.
Is there no risk of confusing visitors if they go around Scotland to different parks where there's different systems in place and the levy's different and it's a flat rate here and a percentage there and there's localised versions of implementation of the scheme? Is that perhaps not a risk that visitors will be confused by it?
I think systems, as I say, we've got many models across Europe. You know, if I go to Florence, I'll pay a percentage rate. If I go to Manchester, I'll pay a flat rate. And it's simply added to your bill. And I think people are very understanding of that. So, again, it will be for the businesses and the operating model and the authority to ensure that the booking of that and the management of that is as easy as possible for both the user and the business. And I think that will be absolutely crucial. I think people out there are, they're used to having a local rate charge on a room rate in many countries and cities. And I don't think it would cause any particular confusion with visitors.
Okay. Thanks very much for that, Councillor McGregor. Is Mirren coming in on that, or is that?
Yeah. Mirren, did you want to come in on this?
Okay. Thanks very much, Kim.
Thank you. Yeah. I just want to come back to the percentage and the flat rate. So you use the example of if you go to Florence, you're going to pay a percentage rate. If you go to Manchester, you pay a flat rate. But what about within a country? Is it common that you would go to Florence and pay a percentage rate and then another place, I don't know what, Venice, and you would pay a flat rate?
as I say, that there are many models, individual countries and particularly municipalities in areas within France that have different models, because the individual municipality has been able to implement what they feel is best for them. As I said earlier, I think in Amsterdam they have a model where in some accommodation it is a percentage rate, in other accommodation it's a flat rate. And I think that comes down to the ease of collection or the nature of the business. And again, in consultation with the authority, what is going to work best in that particular locality. So there are so many models across Europe. I think this is why we require the absolute maximum flexibility to ensure that what we're implementing or what individual councils will implement are going to work for that local area. And as I say, the businesses and the users, that's crucial.
Great. Thank you very much for clarifying that. I'm going to bring in Pam Gosol.
Thank you, Convener. While some witnesses called it an accommodation tax, others asserted that businesses would be taking up the role of unpaid tax collectors for local authorities. Should companies be able to claim a portion of this revenue from tourist taxes to help offset the costs of collecting and reporting levies just the same way as local authorities can do so with the levy fund? My question to Councillor Gail, please.
Yeah, and I know that has been raised by some businesses, and I don't believe that it will be particularly onerous on the business. And this is the crucial thing, that the software and what we use to actually claim that levy back needs to be as straightforward as possible. And I think at the moment, for the areas that do have significantly high pressures from visitor numbers, the onus is on utilising that funding to make the local authority area, and as we've discussed earlier, the street scene, the parks, the theatres, the offering that have a lot of pressure on them in high visitor areas, to have them see the maximum income and investment from that funding. So our view would be that businesses shouldn't get a percentage of that, that the purpose of this funding is for it to come to help to bolster and invest in local services.
Thank you for that answer, Councillor Gill. But don't you think that businesses basically, especially if there's questions on that flat rate and percent, some local authorities may charge different from mechanisms from another. And if there is small micro businesses out there that have one or two, maybe something in the Highlands, then something over in Edinburgh as well, that even their websites, their administration, their accountancy and stuff, that they would need that help. It's just we've heard, obviously, from witnesses that they would ask for some help.
And again, we would hope that councils would discuss with businesses in the local area, because, as you say, one size is not going to fit all. And if they've got a business in Highlands and Islands, it may apply. And if they have a business in Edinburgh, it may apply. But they may have other businesses in local authority areas where the levy is not going to be implemented at all. Mirren, I don't know if there's been much discussion around a percentage of that going back to businesses.
Mirren, would you like to come in?
Thanks. I think you can hear me.
Yes.
Great. Yes, just to say, we are aware that the potential complications that having the local decisions on different types of percentage, maybe applying at different times of the year or not applying at all at places, the complication that can have for businesses. And it's one of the reasons why we are already kind of exploring what the opportunities might be about a single platform for businesses to use in terms of what might be needed behind this, so that there is actually that single experience for them, as opposed to kind of as might be suggested that you have to individually log in to different councils with different systems, et cetera, et cetera. So we are very mindful of that. It's in the very early stages, and it is an exploration, but the potential administrative burden on businesses is recognised, and we are hoping to design systems that will reduce that, and therefore there would be no need, because there wouldn't be any significant additional costs introduced to businesses.
Mm. Okay. Thanks for that, Marion. That actually raises more questions in my mind. I'm curious about, so if you're talking about one single platform across Scotland where local authorities can choose to kind of program in their percentage of their flat rate, that platform, is that a platform that is a relationship between the business and the local authority, or is it three-way where the visitor books their, I'm seeing, no, okay, come on in. Wait, we'll wait for you. I know we have to have these pauses.
Yeah. It wouldn't be an expectation that there would be any interaction with a visitor within that. The expectation is that it would be around any audit requirements, all of the payment and the interaction between any businesses and the local authority in terms of the collection of the levy.
Okay, and that would. Would there be support then for, I mean, I don't know the numbers, but we have heard that there are people who still do their, keep their business in pencil on paper or pen and paper mode. Would there be support for those people to then move into a digital realm?
That's absolutely be something that we have to factor in, because it would have to be usable by businesses as well as local authorities. So I would emphasise again, this is in very early stages. We are engaging with the local government digital office on this.
Great. So. Well, it's great that you're having that conversation about at least a unified user experience in that way. I'm now going to bring in Stephanie Callaghan, who's joining us online.
Thanks very much, convener, and thanks to the panel for being with us today. So first of all, I want to ask you just about the Verity House Agreement, which of course by the default position for that is that there should be no ring fencing or direction of funding. So I'm just wondering, how does that kind of marry up in your view with the Bill's requirements relating to how the levy money is spent? And possibly go to Gail first with that one.
Yeah, as I said, thank you very much. Really good question. As I said earlier, yeah, this has been in the creation now for a number of years, and it actually predates the Verity House. I think it's probably a good example, as I say, of local government working with Scottish Government and all parliamentarians of all parties. We prefer no direction. Obviously, we would, but we've been consistent in our view that the funding that is raised from this is to support the very services that help to bolster tourism and visitor numbers. So it is not a case of that it's ring-fenced as such. It is additional income to support the very services that people rely on when they do visit the areas, whether that be for holidays or for business. It puts a massive burden on local authorities, as we know, particularly at specific times of the year, say in Edinburgh, although Edinburgh is always busy. So the key thing is that it's not there to, it was never intended to bolster other services. So by definition, it would be ring-fenced to be reinvested into the services that support tourism.
And I don't know if...
Marion, do you want to come in?
Yeah, happy to support that. The principle is always that we don't support direction or ring fencing, but the purpose of this funding is to invest in communities. So the money that any funding raised by local authorities that choose to invest in this would be intending to use it for that purpose. So.
Thanks, Stephanie. You've got another question?
Yep. Thank you, convener. Good to see you. Maybe a good indication for the future that Scottish Government and local authorities in COSLA are looking at it in this way. Now, we've already had some examples there around different things that we could do to support visitors in local authorities. Because, of course, we need to make sure the spend is about those visiting for leisure purposes that there's a focus on that there. I'm wondering if there are any other examples of that and also if the objectives should be widened a bit there as well to also cater for business visitors. Thanks.
Gail?
Sorry, I'm just jotting down. yeah, I mean, the examples that we've given earlier would be of benefit to anybody who's visiting an area, whether it be for business or for leisure purposes. I don't really know that I have a huge amount more to add to that. We've been very clear that there are pressures on particularly local authorities, particularly in respect of street scene, parks and open spaces, waste. There's many things. But I think the key thing is that we need to be able to invest in that for the benefit of all visitors, whether it's for business or for leisure.
Thanks for that. Miriam, do you have anything to add?
Just to confirm for clarity that we do think that it should be expanded to cover business tourists as well as leisure, because there are places where they might have sort of different needs and priorities, and therefore we wouldn't want to be excluding kind of a significant part of tourism.
Thanks very much for that. Stephanie, can I come back in?
Thanks very much there. Could I just ask Myrne then, can she give some examples of things in particular that she would like to possibly see then, the expansion relating to? So would that be about digital, about conference venues, or anything that she thinks in particular would be helpful? Thanks.
Myrne?
Yeah, thanks. I mean, I think one of the things, if you think about how business versus leisure tourists might use transport within localities and then travelling to and from localities, that's somewhere where you might have a different response. If you are only able to invest for leisure tourists versus for business tourists as well. So absolutely, what we would want is the ability for areas to be able to consult on and consider what would most benefit the tourists from whatever purpose they're coming here for, and communities as well. So that as Councillor McGregor has been saying, so that this should be mutually beneficial from our view. This should help communities and individuals that live in these localities, and also enhance the tourist experience for both leisure and business tourists.
Great, thanks for that. That's helpful to hear that. I'm now going to come to Mark Griffin, who's also online.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I wanted to touch on an issue that the Scottish Tourism Alliance have raised in evidence when they have said that they would like national parks to receive a share of the investment from the revenue raised. I just wonder if Councillor McGregor, you have any idea of how that could potentially work in practice? They're suggesting, you've got one national park and multiple local authorities, and which cover part of that, and how that even could work.
Thanks very much, Mark. I actually don't know an awful lot about this. It's not a part of it that I've been particularly familiar with. Going back to the point around shared digital that Miriam was making just a moment ago, having that single platform would be designed to ensure that local authorities across boundaries can manage the system easily. So I suppose that would translate into a national park model as well, that if the national park that we currently have sits across many authorities, if we have that shared digital platform, that would make it more manageable across them all. But I'm not aware of the ask from around national parks.
Miriam, you want to come in?
Thanks very much. I would say, so national parks would be part of the consultation process as well. So that gives the opportunity to consider how best the local authority might invest, which would include the national park. We wouldn't support anything that gives any automatic direct funding to national parks. I think that would be, frankly, very complicated anyway, but they wouldn't be excluded from the opportunities of investment where that's deemed locally appropriate following the consultation with communities, tourists, business, and the parks themselves.
Thanks for that. And my second question was around a review. Say the legislation is passed, you know, what is a measure of success? The local authorities have any level of data as to what historic spend has been on the tourism offer versus what it might be post the introduction of a levy? And what do you think we should be looking at in, say, 10 years' time to go back and measure whether this has been a success or not?
I think the measure of any success, I mean, the whole impetus of setting this up is to enhance the offering for your leisure or business visitors in localities to ensure that communities are supported in areas of high pressure. So I suppose the measure would be in 10 years' time that has that investment and income and then sort of filtering that through the investment had a positive impact on the locality. And I think that we can measure that in a very easily in a local way. You know, has it had a positive impact? Are people seeing, you know, a material change in the environment and what they're experiencing when they do visit particular areas? I think it will be for local individual local councils to determine what that success would look like. But for me, the implementation, the whole sort of purpose of this is to create an income to in turn create a better offering for people that are visiting an area, a city, a town, a village, whatever. And I think for me, it's that tangible. Has it made a difference to the locality? Can people see that the streets are cleaner, that the bins are emptied more regularly, that the green space is better looked after and has really nice planting in the summer? That, for me, is the tangible stuff that you'll know as an elected member. You know, the public pick up on things like that and they will relay it back to you. But Mirren might have some information on measures.
Thanks very much. I will admit it's not in terms of how we might measure any outcomes from this that we haven't sort of developed sort of formal positions on it. There is obviously significant reporting and monitoring of local government spend through the local government finance returns, which are put in annually, and that's where evidence can be seen about the significant reduced real terms investment over the last 10 years. So there would be elements of that. But I think Councillor McGregor's point is the key one. It's actually measuring the success in terms of the experience of both communities and visitors within our areas. But to be honest, that's something I might take back to the expert group and leaders and how we might consider that.
That would be wonderful and very welcome. Thank you. I'm glad that our questions are useful this morning. I'd just like to come back on a little bit more on the national parks, because I would be concerned. You talked about the idea of the single platform that could help, and that's welcome. But that the national parks would be part of any local authority consultations. But if a national park has five local authorities and then therefore has to participate in five local consultations, which I think they have to do, they're used to that. But I just I think I have a bit of concern about that those two bodies then having to do that work of looking externally and responding and having different approaches. Just to something there, maybe I think I would welcome a bit more thought from COSLA around how that could be approached, like a more joined up approach from the five local authorities that border a park, for example.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Convener. Yeah, I think all of your questions today have been absolutely brilliant, and there's a couple that are really sort of testing us, which is good, and it will enable us to better scrutinise certain parts of it. Obviously, parts of industry have raised issues as well that we're maybe not as sighted on, and I think this national park question is another one that we'll take back to the officer group and feed in and make sure that that's been given best consideration. I think that this is absolutely key to the introduction of this bill and its subsequent implementation, is that we listen, that we look at areas where there could be problems, and we tease those out before any introduction of the levy, and I think that it's been really useful this morning. So if there's additional on that, we will certainly come back to the committee and give you some more information.
Thank you very much for that. That would be, yeah, very welcome in both cases there. So that actually concludes our questions, and it's been very helpful to have you both here and get a bit more insight and be reminded a little bit also of the history of the process around this starting way back in 2018. So I very much appreciate your evidence today, and I now briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a changeover of witnesses. Our second panel this morning, we are joined by Tom Arthur, who's the Minister for Community Wealth and Public Finance with the Scottish Government. Mr. Arthur is also supported by Scottish Government officials, Ninian Christie, who is a solicitor at the Scottish Government Legal Directorate, Alistair Graham, who's the Policy Advisor at the Local Government and Analytical Services Division, and Ben Haynes, who's the Bill Team Leader for the Visitor Levy Scotland Bill, and I welcome our witnesses this morning. And before we move to questions from members, I invite Mr. Arthur to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the committee. This bill is an important measure, and if passed, will give local authorities a significant new power. A visitor levy can be a force for good, supporting the vitally important visitor economy and bringing benefits to visitors, residents and businesses. The New Deal for Business and the New Deal for Local Government are at the heart of the Government's approach to this measure. We have already taken on board the helpful input we have had from business, local government and others, and I am committed to continuing that meaningful and constructive engagement as we move forward. This will be the first visitor levy in the UK, and the government wants to get it right. As lead minister on the bill, there were several key policy questions I considered, together with my ministerial colleagues, as the proposals in the bill were developed. I want to focus on two of these in my remarks. The first key question was whether it was right to give local authorities this power. The government believes it is. 21 out of 27 EU countries have some kind of visitor levy, and they are commonplace in other locations throughout the world. The opportunity a visitor levy presents is significant and offers councils the opportunity to use the proceeds to invest in their local economy, bringing benefits to residents and visitors alike. International good practice, highlighted by the European Tourism Association, tells us that local consultation is crucial to a successful visitor levy, and the bill would require a local authority to consult local businesses, communities and tourism organisations. Good local engagement will be really important in making sure a visitor levy is well designed and funds it raises will be used to best effect. The second key question I and ministerial colleagues considered in relation to the bill was the balance between local flexibility and national consistency. This is a common thread going through the ongoing debate about whether a national cap is appropriate, the approach you take to exemptions, and the rules around how funding raised by a visitor levy is to be used. The bill takes a middle way between having too rigid or too lax a national framework. It gives local authorities, who are accountable to their electorates, the ability to create a visitor levy that works for their area, whilst providing national consistency in areas as such as how the levy is charged and remitted. We continue to listen to the variety of views from stakeholders on the balance to be struck between local flexibility and national consistency, and we'll listen carefully to the committee's views on this too. One other issue I would like to touch on is the potential for a cruise ship levy. The government recently announced that we will seek to give local authorities the power to create a cruise ship levy. Policy work on the levy is underway in partnership with local government and will lead to a formal public consultation allowing all relevant groups to provide their input to the proposal. We may seek to amend the bill to include a cruise ship levy, but that will very much depend on whether policy development work and a consultation have been completed and the views that Parliament takes on the scope of this bill. We do not want to delay this bill and the power it will give to local authorities if work on a cruise ship levy is not completed in time for it to be added. Lastly, this bill is about looking forward. It seeks to establish a measure now that can deliver sustained investment in the future. It fits with our ambition of fiscally empowering local government and strengthening local democracy, and the vision the government shares with the tourism industry set out in the National Tourism Strategy Scotland Outlook 2030. I very much welcome the committee's scrutiny of this legislation and looking forward to the questions and discussion ahead this morning.
Thanks very much for that helpful opening statement, and it's good to hear that you've been listening to a variety of views through the process. So I'm going to ask a number of questions around the general aims of the bill. So over the time that we've been taking evidence, we heard from representatives of accommodation providers that the bill gives the impression that Scotland has a problem with tourism and that there may be a risk of reputational damage. And also there's been concerns voiced about the impacts of Scotland's competitiveness. And I wonder what your thoughts are on those two perspectives.
Scotland is a world-class tourist destination, and that is down to the professionalism, dedication and hard work of all those working across the visitor economy in Scotland. What this levy is about, this bill is about, is creating what is a discretionary power for local authorities, democratically accountable to their electorates to determine whether or not they use but which will provide a power to raise additional revenue to invest in the visitor economy. That's why we have at the heart of this legislation that requirement to consult for local authorities wishing to introduce a visitor levy to set out what they understand the impact of the levy would be. What I see this power as having is the potential to generate valuable extra investment to enhance and to support and to develop the offering, the world-class offering that Scotland already gives. And that local flexibility is important because what it allows is for local authorities considering introducing a levy in consultation with business and their communities and other interested parties in their area to consider and develop a levy that can really add value, that can provide a significant return on investment. So I very much recognise, the government recognises, the immense contribution the visitor economy, the accommodation sector makes specifically to Scotland. And we see this bill as an opportunity for that discretionary power to help to enhance that offering.
Thanks very much for that. And continuing on the theme of concerns that have been raised by business groups, one company told us that the bill looks like localism for localism's sake. And I'd be interested to hear what your thoughts are around the proposal for local flexibility and variations that might, and the concerns that that might lead to confusion and complexity for customers and businesses.
As I touched on in my opening statement, I very much recognise the importance of getting the balance right between national consistency and avoiding any unnecessary administrative variation, but allowing that local flexibility to allow local areas to respond to the assets and needs of their particular areas. What would be a powerful and logical investment in the visitor economy here in Edinburgh might not necessarily be so in another part of Scotland, for example, in the Highlands. So is that local flexibility to allow local authorities through consultation with business, with those who are active in the visitor economy in their area, to ensure that revenue raised and the way in which the revenue is raised through the visitor levy scheme is appropriate in response to those local circumstances and gets the best return on investment for each particular area?
Thanks very much for that. And I think it's good that you highlight again that it's local authorities aren't just going to do this. They're going to be required to actually carry out a consultation with all stakeholders. My third question is around the concerns that have been raised that the visitor levy will be effectively a tax on accommodation providers rather than a tax on visitors. And I wondered what your thoughts are on that.
Well, I'm very conscious of the need to be talking about this as a visitor levy. I'm very deliberate in the use of our language. This is an opportunity to raise revenue that will be invested back into the visitor economy. In terms of where the charge lies, there needs to be an efficient an effective way of administering this tax. So in this case, just as businesses would collect other taxes, this would be the process by which this levy would operate. For example, visitors coming from other parts of the world, if the charge was directly on the visitor, there might be difficult challenges there around compliance and enforcement for people who live out with the jurisdiction in which we operate. So I'm very keen, as we have been already, to continue to engage with business to ensure that we get an administrative regime that is as efficient and is as light touch as possible, and where we can find national consistency to do so. That is also why we asked Visit Scotland to convene an expert group with representatives from local government and from the visitor economy. And that is important because what it will enable them to do is to develop best practice and guidance to support local authorities in implementing a visitor levy, should Parliament pass the bill and should local authorities choose to use the power.
Thank you very much for that response. And it's good to hear again about the Visit Scotland expert group and that we're getting that insight from the people who have experience in those areas. I'm now going to move on to questions around how the levy revenues will be raised, and I'm going to bring in Pam Gosol.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and good morning to the rest of the panel as well. Minister, you just spoke about there in your opening statement how it's important to strike the balance, basically having the national consistency and local authority flexibility. So we've obviously heard witnesses come in here and give evidence on that some prefer the percentage rate, some prefer the flat rate. But however, industry appears to have the view that to make it more simpler to collect this levy, that they would like basically the levy to be around a flat rate, to adopt a flat rate. And so do you think that the bill should be amended to allow local authorities to introduce a flat rate if they decided that was the most appropriate process to go down?
Thank you very much. I think it's an excellent question, and we appreciate it's one of the key issues that's emerged in the committee's deliberations. It's certainly something that's been consistently raised with me and my officials in our engagement with accommodation providers. I think as a starting principle, I think I'd hope we would all agree there probably should be uniformity. It should either be a flat rate or it should be a percentage fee. I think that's something that accommodation providers may well look for, is consistency. If we're going to have a percentage rate, then that's what should be in the bill and should be applicable across all local authorities seeking to use the power. And conversely, a flat rate, it should be a flat rate. I recognise there's strong views in support of VERA argument. Clearly, a percentage allows for a more proportionate and progressive approach. It would recognise that someone staying in a suite in a five-star hotel would be subject to a different rate than someone who was staying in budget accommodation, for example. And I'm conscious that that is something that will be a key concern. But I also recognise challenges around questions that are raised by industry around the compliance and administrative burden that would entail. So I appreciate options for a flat rate range from a single flat rate to a tiered structure. Potentially with a tiered structure, we start to add in additional complexity, which a flat rate would be seeking to solve by moving from a percentage rate. So I think it's important to consider this in detail. What I want to say today is that I'm very open to having these discussions. I'm also very keen on this and a number of other issues to understand the view that the committee forms when it publishes its report ahead of stage one. So on this, I am open to looking at amendments to changing to a flat rate, but it's something that will require further detailed consideration and engagement with industry, and indeed I'm happy to follow up with the committee ahead of stage two in that matter as well. I think there's strong arguments either way. I recognise there's a strong view from industry. I recognise there's a mix of views from local authorities as well. And as I've said, what I want to ensure is that, yes, we can have a system that is fair and progressive in terms of the levy actually applied, but equally that it is efficient and straightforward to administer and does not impose undue burdens of compliance, particularly on smaller operators.
Thank you for that response, Minister. You talk about consistency, and some of the things we've heard, we had witnesses in that looked at the international models, and in one place that we've seen that both flat rates and percentages have been applied. So if there's something that you end up going in the bill down, do you think it would be you setting it, whether it's flat or percentage, or whether it would be the local authorities?
At this stage, my view would be that it would be for Parliament to determine legislation whether or not the model is a flat rate or a percentage. Again, I'm not wanting to rule any particular position out. I'm open to hearing what views are, because I recognise there are a range of views. A compromise position is potentially to allow for local authorities to determine themselves, but I'm conscious that there would be, may well be, a view from industry that would just add further complexity. One of the motives for the flat rate is because of the complexity involved in administering a percentage rate, particularly for smaller operators. If we had a set of circumstances whereby there was variation between different authorities between flat rate and percentage, that would not address that issue around complexity. So I would want to explore this in further detail in a way that is consistent with the New Deal for Business and the New Deal with local government, to understand what the views of both local authorities are and businesses. I recognise that for industry there's a, I think there's a clear lean towards a flat rate. I recognise the views for local government are mixed. My own views in terms of what we settle on will ultimately be a matter for Parliament to determine in the legislation. I think at this point, from my perspective, is that what Parliament lands on, there should be consistency. It should either be a flat rate or it should either be a percentage. But again, I don't want to preempt further discussions with colleagues in local government to understand what their views are. But I'm just conscious if we were to change what's in the bill as introduced, i.e. moving from a percentage to a flat rate, with the stated objective of simplifying administration, then that would be undermined if we actually potentially took up an approach which further complicated it, which could be through local discretion or indeed some of the potential unintended consequences of having a tiered system of flat rates, which again can help to address some of the issues around it being a less progressive approach than a percentage, but can add further complexity. So I appreciate there is a lot of complexity in that answer. I'll be very keen to hear the sort of considered reflections of the committee in the report, and I'll be having further engagement with the sector and with local government ahead of the Stage 1 debate and Stage 2.
Thank you, Minister. My next question is around the national cap. While local authorities are not generally keen on a national cap, the tourism sector has made calls for a nationally set cap in the case that the percent rate remains the only option for local authorities. What is the government's response to these suggestions?
Well, clearly the question of a national cap is predicated upon what we have in the bill as introduced around a percent rate. So that could potentially change depending on the views that Parliament takes as we move to consideration of amendments. I recognise why there are calls for a national cap, but I'm also very much committed to this being about empowering local government and doing this with local government, consistent with the New Deal with local government. And where we are a number of powers within, delegated powers within the legislation that allow ministers to amend and specify details of what's required in legislation, these are useful provisions to have that would help us to respond to circumstances and changes going forward. A national cap is, I appreciate, could be perceived and may well be regarded as an intrusion into what would be the autonomy and decision-making space of local government, because part of the process of consulting and engaging is for local government to assess the impact a visitor levy would have, and clearly in determining should it go forward as introduced with a percentage rate, local government would want to consider what the economic impact would be, and recognising that there's a balance between a percentage level which would raise sufficient revenue to fund that reinvestment in the visitor economy set out in the scheme, but not a level that was so excessive that it could start to have a negative economic impact. And I would want to trust, I think as we all would, that is a decision for democratically accountable elected members in local government to take. But I do recognise the concerns the industry have. So again, this is something that I'm keen to have further dialogue on and further engagement. It's very important to me that we do this in a way that is as collaborative as possible, and that includes with business and with local government, but equally to hear what the views of Parliament are as well. So again, my instinctively, and this is reflected in introducing the bill, my view would be that is a decision for local government to take. But I recognise the concerns that have been raised, and I want to explore that further with local government, with business, and of course to have an opportunity to reflect on what the committee's views are on the matter.
Thank you. Thanks, Pam. I actually just want to come back on the flat rate and percentage rate, because I feel like there's something that interesting came up in our previous panel with COSLA, which was the request for ultimate flexibility and to be able to either choose at a local level flat or percentage. And I take your point and also the points that other people have brought in that What we're trying to do is create something that is user-friendly, simple, efficient, that kind of thing. But I wondered if there'd been any discussion, and also because I said that there are ongoing discussions in quite a number of areas, I wondered if there's been any discussion around the potential for an IT platform that could make the process of calculating, collecting, and auditing. So if a local authority went for a flat rate and another one went for a percentage, there's a digital IT platform. COSLA mentioned they're exploring that with COSLA digital IT team. If there was a platform that would then make it, you know, kind of take out the difficulty because we're using IT to help us with that. I wondered if the expert working group has had any discussions about that, exploring that possibility.
I don't believe that the expert working group has had specific discussions in that area. More broadly, digitisation of public services is a significant area that warrant many committee sessions. It's something that is also being discussed as part of our broader work and engagement around changes and improvements to the administration and operation of a non-domestic rate system, for example. That's more of a medium to longer term piece of work. So this is a live matter. It's something that we'd obviously have to be considering around timelines, when such a system would become operational, scope, how, also recognising that this, and again, this is an interesting point with regards to variation between authorities, is that the bill allows for two or more authorities to work together to develop a visitor levy for a particular area, something that has a particular interest to our national parks, for example. So there's a number of different factors to consider in that regard. And I'm conscious as well that should the bill progress through Parliament and be approved in a reasonable timescale, then the earliest that a visitor levy would come on would become online, would probably be sort of the first half of 2026. So again, there'd be a question about whether any new platforms as such would be developed and operational by that point. But these are, in terms of the actual administration from a local authority perspective, again, these are discussions that I'll be keen to pick up on in considering amendments ahead of stage two. I do appreciate the point made by local government colleagues around ensuring maximum flexibility, but I think we'd all recognise that we want to ensure a system that commands the full confidence of business, and that we are ensuring that the operation of this system is as straightforward and as streamlined as it can be, while allowing that local autonomy so that ultimately these revenues that are raised can be reinvested in a way that is most impactful and gets the biggest return on investment for the visitor economy.
Thanks for that response. Yeah, I think that I hear the point about being streamlined for business, and I'm also, I can remember back to the evidence session when we had local authorities and we had Edinburgh, the two of our local authorities that are most, they're most impacted by tourism, Edinburgh and Highland, Edinburgh wanting a percentage and Highland asking not only for a flat rate but to be able to bring in that tiering system. So it is interesting, we're not getting a kind of consistent picture across local authorities, and obviously there is a local need, and kind of they've been looking into it. I think both of those local authorities are quite far down the line in terms of having done work and the kind of keenness to bring this in. So it's important to consider their perspectives, but I really take the point that any kind of creation of a digital platform that would work, that takes time to implement. Now I'm going to bring in Marie McNair.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister and your officials. On the announcement that the Scottish Government may seek to amend the bill to include cruise ships, I welcome your earlier comments on the proposed consultation. But can I ask what engagement there was with the cruise ship industry and the port authorities prior to the announcement being made?
There has been some discussion and engagement. This was something that had is not an entirely new proposal. There had been various advocates for it over a number of years. But what we have undertaken is, having made that announcement, is consistent with our approach in the New Deal for Businesses to have that detailed engagement going forward. There's already a working group between Scottish Government and COSLA officials which is looking at this matter. Clearly, with regards to any potential amendments to this bill, to make provision for a cruise ship levy will be determined by the pace of progress. We will need to have a public consultation, and it's of vital importance, I know, to colleagues in COSLAS and government that we are able to, subject to the Agreement Parliament, pass this bill in a way that would allow the powers to come online as we hope to be for the early part of 2026. So I would not want to find myself in a situation whereby, because there's further work needed or required in the development of a cruise ship levy model, that would hold up the work of this bill. So, as I say, if we make sufficient progress and are able to complete that public consultation and have that level of engagement required with industry, with local government, on a cruise ship levy, then there is, you know, open to look at amending the bill to include that provision. But it's very important that we get that right. I would not want to unduly rush it, and if it takes more time, I would not want that to hold up the progress of this bill through Parliament.
Thanks for that response. In sort of some of the rural areas, there's one criticism of the bill is, like, you know, some of the motorhomes and wild campers are not covered. What work would the Scottish Government do to explore how these visitors could be included in the scope of the bill?
Well, but there's other areas in terms of the issue around motorhomes and wild camping, which are covered in terms of managing those particular some of the challenges that arise from that elsewhere within our overall work in tourism and the visitor economy. In terms of the bill specifically, I think one of the challenges around a motorhome, for example, would be determining what would be around administration and compliance and enforcement. What is the chargeable event? There's quite a clear definition in the legislation about what the chargeable event is in overnight accommodation. Now, motorhomes that were going to, you know, for example, a campsite, etc., that was subject to visitor levy and paying for a berth, etc., that is captured. The points around where that is not taking place, the question would be, how is it actually, how do you administer it? Now, I'm conscious that we're not familiar with many examples, if really any, of a particular levy on or charge on motorhomes. I think New Zealand, if I'm correct, you have a very defined geographical area with a single point of entry. So I'm open to having, again, further discussions on this, but I think that it does raise some particular challenges around administration and trying to find a way in which that can be consistent with the way in which the bill is drafted. And as I say, we spoke a lot about wanting to ensure we have a system in place which is straightforward for business. Similarly, for the tax authority, local government in this case, we want to ensure that as well. Ben, I don't know if there's anything you'd want to add about motorhomes and camper vans.
No, I mean, there's work underway. Visitor Management Group, led by Visit Scotland, has been established to seek a kind of cross-government approach to addressing the issues that can sometimes be around motorhomes. So there is work underway on that aspect, and I would just echo the Minister's point that, you know, we are open to engagement and discussion with stakeholders on this, but we are very aware that the chargeable event looks very different than the chargeable event that's currently in the bill.
Thank you for that. Finally, the committee heard suggestions that there are certain providers currently covered by the bill that should not be. Obviously, you probably the boat moorings. Minister, would you like to kind of respond to these suggestions?
Yeah, I've been very grateful for the engagement with the sector, particularly our parliamentary colleague, Stuart McMillan, who convenes the cross-party group on recreational boating and marine tourism. I had a meeting with that group earlier in the autumn, and they raised a number of issues. I am again grateful to Mr McMillan, who is convening a roundtable with the sector on Friday, which I will be attending to have further discussions. Clearly, there was concern expressed that the legislation may unintentionally capture certain activity that is not consistent with the policy intention. So we're having close discussions to ensure that these issues are fully understood, and if required, we would bring forward amendments to clarify the position at stage two. but recognising I'm familiar with the concerns raised by the sector. I recognise them. I'm very grateful for their considered engagement, and as I say, we'll be taking that forward indeed on Friday of this week to fully ensure that there's no unintentional capturing of particular activities that would be inconsistent with the policy intent of the legislation.
Thank you, Minister. So many thanks.
Thank you very much, Marie. I'm going to bring in Pam Goodall.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, you said in your opening statement that the basic levy, it's important the levy has to be spent in the local authority areas. So I wanted to ask a question around last week. I raised some concerns, and I also raised it earlier on as well with the witnesses, that this revenue from the visitor levy would be used to plug holes in council budgets. It's a very grey area. And how would you respond to concerns that, in essence, the tourists and businesses are paying the price for the Scottish Government's inability to give our councils a fair funding deal for years, and whether you agree that the revenue should be ring-fenced for tourist-related spending, and how you foresee the working that works in practice, especially how it fits into the spirit of the Verity House Agreement as well?
The revenue that is raised through any visitor levy is not intended to be a substitute for any other revenue. Indeed, the revenue that is raised has to be hypothecated for spend on facilities and services that help support the visitor economy. There's a clear definition of that within the legislation. Local authorities have to account for it separately. They have to publish a report, and they have to review after 3 years. Prior to the introduction, in terms of proposing a scheme, there's a requirement to set out what the objectives are of the scheme, and the objectives have to be consistent with the definition in the bill of supporting the visitor economy. So that is clearly set out. Now, if there are particular concerns around the specific wording or the definition that is used by industry, I would, of course, want to have that discussion engagement to ensure that there's clarity. What we have sought to do is to, in the legislation, is be very clear that revenue raised from visitor levy is accounted for separately. There's transparency about how it is spent, both in terms of the intention and the reporting on that. And decisions around how a scheme is developed, i.e. what the objectives, specific local objectives will be determined through by the local authority, through engagement and consultation with accommodation providers, DMOs, businesses, communities in their particular area. So if there are concerns around the wording, I'm more than happy to hear that specifically. But the clear policy intent is that revenue used is there to support the visitor economy. And I think that is of paramount importance to me. And it's ensuring there's a balance there between giving that confidence and certainty, but also recognising the degree of flexibility that is required so that local authorities can respond to the assets and needs of their particular area. But again, that is something that, if there is concerns around any specific aspect of the wording, I'm more than happy to have that engagement to ensure that we have wording that commands the confidence of both local government and business.
Thank you for that response, Minister. But Minister, how would you see that working with grey areas? You know, we've been speaking the last couple of weeks about things like bins, roads, potholes. So one would assume that day-to-day, that would be the council's responsibility, and obviously they're in cuts. But obviously it's used for tourism as well, and visitor economy, the roads and the bins. So how would you strike that balance that day-to-day work isn't being now taken from the levy rather than should be from the budget?
I think it's an absolutely fair and reasonable question. There could be a temptation, though, in responding to start to get into a prescriptive list of what is in within scope and what is out with scope, and that would clearly be counter to the intention of a bill that's about the fiscal empowerment of local government and for them to determine how that revenue is spent, consistent with the legislation. I would also not want to prejudge what those involved in the visitor economy in a particular area might regard as priorities for their particular area. I recognise the concern that you express that there could be too liberal an interpretation of the legislation, and as such, the revenue would not be used in a way that was felt to be consistent with the principles of the Bill of Supporting the Visitor Economy. But that's why we have the provision around consultation. So there has to be that. The council, a local authority seeking to introduce a visitor levy, would have to set out a scheme consistent with the objectives. It would have to be consulted on with businesses, with the community, and that would, you know, capture all of the various parties and interests. Have to be, the local authority would have to set out what they believe the impact would be, and then they would have to report on it. So there would be that transparency and clarity. And ultimately, these are decisions that are going to be taken by elected members who are democratically accountable to their electorates. If, as I say, if there are specific concerns around the wording, I'm more than happy to have these conversations. Where I would not want to get into is a situation where ministers are starting to, you know, devise, you know, prescriptive lists of what is within scope and out with scope, because as well as undermining that local autonomy and accountability, which is at the heart of the new deal with local government and what this bill is seeking to do in terms of fiscal empowerment, it could have unintended consequences, because it is not for me to say what the priority is for stakeholders and visitor economy in one part of the country. I recognise that that will be different. But as I say, I think it's a fair question to ask, and if it are specific concerns around the wording, more than happy to explore that further to ensure we get this right and it can command confidence.
Thanks very much. That's very good to hear your thoughts on that. And continuing on the theme of how revenues will be spent, I'm going to bring in Stephanie Callaghan, who's joining us online.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thank you for coming along, Minister. So the bill requires that money raised should be spent on services benefiting those visiting the local authorities area for leisure purposes. Can you comment on why this requirement was included? And also, secondly, we heard from Mirren Kelly earlier that business visitors might have specific requirements around travel, for example. So I'm wondering if you see a need to widen those objectives, perhaps including business as well as leisure, or should the original plans around engagement and scope satisfy this? Thanks.
Thank you very much. It's an interesting question, because we can see there could be a tension to broaden the definition, and there can also be an ask to narrow the definition. And what we have reflected, I'm not saying we have necessarily nailed it and got the Goldilocks zone just perfect, but I think we've got pretty close to it. But as I say, I reiterate that commitment to have further engagement with industry around the wording and with local government too. I think the point around business visitors is an important one, and particularly given we have such a strong events sector in Scotland, it's something that we have to be cognisant of. In terms of why this requirement is within the legislation, it is the policy intent is developed over a number of years that this is specifically about generating revenue for the visitor economy as opposed to a general revenue raising tool. Were you to move into a general revenue raising tool, then you have to, we would have to recognise that there is significant variation on the size of the visitor economy between different parts of Scotland. So yes, that does mean different economic impact, but with a visitor levy applied in such a context, that would create different, quite significantly different and varying revenue generating opportunities. So if it was a general power, that would, I think, would understandably invite questions around equity and fairness and how that would play into the overall local government funding formula. But as I say, that's not what the this legislation is about. This is about creating a discretionary power for local authorities that can raise revenue from the visitor economy to support investment into the visitor economy. And I would hope with the ambition of actually increasing the offering and ensuring we have a sustainable future for our tourism sector, and to enhance that world-class offering that we already provide.
Thanks very much for that. Sorry, I'm not sure if you can hear me.
We can, yes.
Okay. I do apologise. Thanks very much for that, Minister. And it's good to know there's still that openness and listening going on there as well. And that might welcome in my second question as well. So the Scottish Tourism Alliance would like to see the national parks receiving a fair share of investment from the revenue that's raised from the visitor levy, clearly. And I'm wondering, do you have any ideas around how this might work in practice, potentially with one park authority having up to five local authority areas? And I'm wondering if you've got any views on the potential for perhaps a regional levy scheme or something else. Thanks.
Yes, I've met with both of our national parks and had very useful discussions. And one of the things that I'm taking away from those discussions, and again, be grateful for the committee's views on this, is to consider whether there has to be any further provision within the legislation around how national parks are engaged with, but recognising that this is a scheme for local authorities to administer as the tax authority. Now, within the legislation as introduced, as I touched on earlier, there is that ability for local authorities, two or more local authorities, to work together. So you can imagine, for example, authorities which share share areas of a national park could work together to develop a specific levy that would cover a national park. That would be a decision for individual local authorities working together collaboratively. Similarly, on that point around a regional approach, again, that provision within the legislation to allow local authorities to work together would allow for a number of councils to collaborate on a visitor levy and to make decisions around how most, through consultation and engagement, around how most meaningfully and impactfully to utilise that revenue within their particular region. These will ultimately be decisions for individual local authorities to take. Well, notwithstanding that, I would reiterate the point that we'll be considering what further measures may be required to ensure that the voice of the national parks is appropriately recognised, including necessary on the in the legislation. But I think there's sufficient flexibility there. What I'm keen to ensure that in terms of the framework that the legislation provides is something that is as straightforward to administer as it possibly can be, while retaining that flexibility to allow local authorities to respond either individually or collectively to the needs and assets of their particular area.
Thank you.
Thanks, Stephanie. I'm now going to bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good morning to your officials as well. I just wanted to get a piece of clarification with regards to cruise ships, because I think 2 weeks ago your Green Minister colleague was quite clear that it would be part of this bill. I think what you're saying today is there will need to be a consultation, and given the fact that we are scrutinising the bill, it's probably unlikely it will be included in this legislation. Is that right?
To be clear, there will require to be a public consultation. Again, if we make quite quick progress and at pace, and depending on the parliamentary timetable for this legislation, there may be the opportunity for amendments. But equally, I do not want to unduly rush the development of a cruise levy proposal and for that to have any impact upon the projected timescales for this legislation.
Okay, thank you for that. My questions were in relation to exemptions, and it's something I've been trying to pursue throughout our work on this. The government currently have a voucher scheme proposed within the bill. It's not been clear to date how accommodation providers would be able to check individuals who do think they're not eligible to pay a visitor levy, and just wondered what work was going on, because I think there's been broad consensus that some people shouldn't be paying this. For example, people visiting children in hospital, people visiting family members in prison, and quite a broad range of people who I think should be exempt. You're answering quite a few questions of mine around this at the minute, and I think that's quite important we get that right before the bill goes into where it's going to be administered, and that's likely to be hotels and individual businesses. So just wondered what government thinking was around how exemptions will work in practice.
It's a question that gets to the heart of this national consistency, local flexibility issue. I can appreciate a view may be formed in Parliament that there are certain areas which are should clearly be certain categories of individual circumstances should be exempt wherever, regardless of location. I'm also conscious, though, that of the importance of local autonomy in being able to decide what is best for their particular area. And I'm also conscious of ensuring that we can provide as much simplicity in terms of administration, both for local authorities and businesses, as possible. Now, the legislation allows for those, for the exemptions to be determined locally. There is the work that's been undertaken by the expert group around best practice and guidance. It may be something that the expert group could consider as part of its work. But in terms of getting the balance right, I want to ensure that there is that opportunity for business communities and local government working together, engaging through consultation to determine what are the best, you know, suite of exemptions, if any, for their particular area beyond what's on the face of the bill. I don't know, is there anything you'd want to add?
Yeah, just to add a couple of things on that. The expert group has had an initial discussion about exemptions. That's something that is very much in their work plan, producing guidance on that. We, as in Scottish Government, are trying to facilitate, or we are facilitating, a discussion between business organisations on one hand and local government on the other about the best way to administer any exemptions that are put in place. You're right, there is provision in the bill around vouchers. That's just there to create that as an option for a local authority, or if it wants to go down that route. But we don't have any set views on how exemptions should be administered.
OK, thanks for that. I think it's maybe important some clear work's done on this, because I think there is many, I think we've had quite a broad number of people saying they do want to see people exempt from this, but given the nature of what is an accommodation tax, not just about tourists and visitors, how that's going to be administered, not within businesses or necessarily councils, is really kind of, there's no detail around that, and a voucher scheme doesn't seem to cover that. So I think it's really important, if it's taken forward, that that's looked at. I wanted to move on to some of the criticisms which tourism organisations have made around the assumptions and calculations used currently within the financial memorandum to date, and just wondered what the Minister's view was on that, especially you've touched upon some potential changing environments we might see before this bill comes forward, and what we've seen in relation to online platforms, credit card charging, especially, and how small businesses will actually be able to administer this.
Mm-hmm. We've saw, and particularly through the work in what's quite an extensive BRIA, to detail what our understanding of the various costs would be, both in compliance and administration. I think we just ask Alistair to come in to give a bit of background on how this work has been developed and what our current understanding is.
The BRIA has been informed with engagement with businesses, both from our 2018 national discussion and consultation responses from our 2019 public consultation. This was then followed up by 20 face-to-face interviews in 2019 with individual businesses from the overnight accommodation sector. Following the pause in the legislation being brought forward due to the pandemic, a follow-up survey was issued to these businesses with a particular focus on understanding the compliance challenges associated with specific proposals in the visitor levy bill. And also we've been engaging with officials who've been involved in administering tourist taxes in Nice, Amsterdam and Toronto to understand the resources required to collect visitor levy type taxes in other contexts. In addition, we've also been engaging with third-party OTAs like Booking.com, Airbnb and with property management system providers to understand how their systems will interact with the introduction of a visitor levy.
Okay, thank you for that. And have government been in touch with the Manchester scheme as well? That's the only one obviously currently operational in the UK.
Well, the thing with the Manchester scheme is it's distinct in the sense it's a business improvement district as opposed to a local authority administered visitor levy. There is consideration of a bid model given within the BRIA. What we have sought to do and take forward in partnership with local government and engagement with business is a different approach where it would be administered by the local authority. With bids, you have obviously a balloting process that can create uncertainty about longer term stability of revenues. There's also comes with being a local government administered scheme, and the work it's on will be ongoing with consultation requirement that
democratic accountability of elected members taking the decision locally. So while there are various ways in which it can be considered in terms of meeting the objectives of the policy intention, the bid was not deemed as capable of doing that. Hence, we've taken forward the visitor levy approach for local authorities that we have set out in the bill. Good out. Thanks. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Miles. Continuing on this theme, I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and your colleagues. Tom, you must be aware of the discussion around the VAT threshold, the £85,000 threshold that's been discussed at several of the committee meetings, and the fear that some of the smaller businesses might, because of the levy, push beyond the £85,000 limit and be subject to VAT. What does the government have to say to those businesses that might fall into that particular trap?
Well, I very much recognise the points that that have been raised. Clearly, VAT is a reserve tax, and the introduction of the bill. I wrote to the UK government, who have responded. We've shared that correspondence with the committee, setting out the views expressed by the UK government on the matter. What I would say is that, given this is a locally administered levy, this is something that local authorities considering introducing a visitor levy will have to take into account. There is that requirement to consider the economic impact of introducing a visitor levy set out within the legislation. So that is something that local authorities will have to consider carefully. And I think that speaks to the importance of that process of consultation and engagement which is required to precede the introduction of a visitor levy. So I think it's a fair and it's a legitimate point that is raised, and it will be for local authorities, should this bill be passed, who are considering introducing a levy, to take that into account in their decision-making.
Yeah, I mean, some businesses were saying they might be facing having to reduce the number of bed nights available to not pass this threshold, which kind of sounds as if it's rounding counterproductive to the aims of the policy. Is that so? Would you say then that it's down to the local authorities to try to manage this? But frankly, I can't see how they can avoid this. VAT is paid on the levy, and then that's chargeable, and so on and so forth.
Well, there's a number of flexibilities around how a scheme can be developed. For example, the particular areas within the authority, the timescales in which it applies, and as such, these would be flexibilities that can be applied to address a whole range of different aspects of considerations around how a levy should be administered and applied in a local area. But there are flexibilities there which local authorities could potentially deploy in response to some of these considerations. But it would be for local authorities to take into account the circumstances of those who are trading just below the VAT threshold, which I recognise is a consideration that many businesses, particularly small and micro businesses, have to take into account. I think, again, that speaks to reiterate the point of the importance of that consultation and engagement, and local authorities being able to set out their understanding of the impact of introducing a levy as being crucial to ensure that that is taken into account.
Okay. On the issue of recouping administrative costs, we understand the bill permits the local authorities to do that, but we also understand that it doesn't permit local businesses to have an element of recouping costs here. How does the government see that particular issue? It's been discussed several times over the recent weeks as well.
I'm not aware of any tax operating within the UK whereby costs of complying with the tax can be reclaimed. But there would be nothing preventing a local authority from, should they choose as part of their way of operating the levy, from supporting or reimbursing businesses for the cost of compliance. But that would be a matter for an individual local authority to determine. I would just want to confirm, do we have anything in any examples of tax? It's being the compliance cost for tax has been reimbursed.
Yeah, we're not aware of any examples in the UK of people being able, businesses being able to extract from the tax the costs of the administration There's no precedent for that that we are aware of.
Is it correct to say that the bill actually allows local authorities to recoup their administration costs?
Well, the revenue would be net of administration costs that would be deployed in terms of supporting the objectives of the scheme. Mm-hmm. But there is nothing that would prevent a local authority from using a portion of the revenue generated from the scheme to support those accommodation providers and their compliance costs. Again, that would be a matter for a local authority. It would be at their discretion and something that local stakeholders would want to perhaps consider and engage with the local authority on, but it's a matter for the local authority.
That's quite helpful, actually. Thanks very much for that, Tom. Thanks.
Yeah, thanks very much. Really, that was helpful. I'm now going to bring in Mark Griffin, who's joining us online.
Thanks, Kamina. Morning, Minister. I just wanted to ask if the legislation passes through the parliamentary process and is implemented, what do you see as the key ways that we should measure the impact of the legislation, or what? What should our successor committees be looking at in 10 years' time to see if the bills had the desired effect?
I think it's an important question, and I think it does actually help to be thinking about post-legislative scrutiny right at the outset, as much as we're still to have a stage one vote. I suppose there's two aspects. I think one would be that opportunity for continuous monitoring based upon local authorities that choose to introduce a visitor levy. They will be required to report, and that report, 18 months after introduction, then annual review after 3 years. And that in itself will provide a degree of data that can be interrogated and analysed in terms of understanding how the visitor levy is operating within particular areas. Through the work, certainly on the new deal with local government and Verity House and that close engagement with local government, clearly any issues that were to arise or suggestions for improvement in terms of the way in which the framework for the administration set out in legislation, I think they would arise through that. I think parliamentary engagement, of course, with local government in COSLA, again, there would be opportunities where through the cumulative process of different local authorities taking forward this levy, what the learning had been and any suggested improvements and ways in which the impact could be measured cumulatively across Scotland as well as within individual local authorities, that opportunity would be afforded. And equally importantly, certainly from a government perspective, through the New Deal for Business and that close engagement, there would be these opportunities for feedback and consideration, including how any cumulative impacts that a visitor levy would have in relation to other legislative or regulatory requirements. And again, relevant committees in the Parliament engaging with business would have that opportunity as well. But in terms of being able to anchor this objectively in data, the reporting and review requirements set out in the legislation for local authorities would be able in that first instance to give indication of what impact a visitor levy was having, and indeed is a visitor levy in a specific local authority, is it meeting the objectives as set out in the scheme? And I think over time, as we go through this process and learning takes place, and this will be a process of learning and getting engagement for any local authority that takes forward the visitor levy. I think there will be opportunities for local authorities through that consultation with business and their communities to determine what works best. And I imagine there will be periods of, in terms of through that review process, there will be reflection upon what has worked well, what perhaps has not achieved the aims it set out, and that would inform future iterations of the visitor levy should a local authority choose to continue with it. So through the review and reporting and through the ongoing dialogue that takes place between business, local government and Parliament, and similarly with the Scottish Government, I think there'll be ample opportunity to evaluate and to measure the impact of this legislation going forward.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Kevin.
Thanks very much, for that question, Mark, and thanks for the thoughtful, extensive response around how we measure the impact. Now, I would imagine that it's something for local authorities also to perhaps ask in their consultations. I just want to bring in Stephanie Callaghan, who's got a supplementary on this matter.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, there does seem to have been limited thought around data collection to measure the success, and while this will be delivered by local authorities, I can't imagine that the Scottish Parliament will be asking the Scottish Government for evidence of this bill's success. So I'd be really interested to hear any thoughts that you might be having already around what quantitative or qualitative data might be key to measuring what's working really well. And just for clarity, are you saying there's likely to be a common framework for measuring that key quantitative and qualitative data and outcomes across all local authorities that are participating? Thanks.
Firstly, I would say local authorities, we routinely consult and engage on a number of issues, and they are best placed to determine and how that process is carried out. I think in terms of how, as this would be a local government scheme operating within legislation determined by Parliament, it will ultimately, I think Parliament, I imagine, will take an interest in how this is operating, and I imagine future committees will want to explore post-legislative scrutiny on this. In terms of this being a local power, and as I've set out before, the various requirements around consultation and reporting, there is that transparency there. So I imagine that the consideration will be particularly given to what the stated scheme objectives are for deployment of revenue generated from a visitor levy, and whether or not these objectives are met, and if they are, to what degree they are met. And that in itself will, I think, inform, as I touched on earlier, future iterations of a visitor levy, should a local authority, seek to continue with it. I imagine that local authorities, and it would be, I imagine, an expectation of business and communities following introduction of a visitor levy, that there will be keen interest and continued engagement with local government. Now, these are obviously matters for individual councils to consider in a way that's consistent with the legislation. But I think the for this to be a success, it will require that collaboration and that partnership working that is, I think, inherent in the requirement to consult and engage. And certainly I know from my engagement with local authorities who have expressed an interest in taking forward the visitor levy, there is a strong desire to work in partnership with the communities and the businesses that, that they represent, to ensure this can be a success. But I think the important things around the clearly setting out through consultation and scheme of what the objectives are and the reporting on that gives that important data to then evaluate and measure on specific objectives. And clearly there can be further work undertaken over perhaps the medium to longer term in terms of economic impact and analysis of whether those interventions and those objectives have proven successful in being able to enhance the economic performance of the visitor economy in a particular area. But again, these will be matters for local authorities to determine, just as all governments will routinely and review their broader suite of policies.
Yeah, come back in, Stephanie, if you want to.
Thanks very much. I suppose, Minister, that sometimes, having been a councillor at local authorities myself, sometimes we find ourselves kind of comparing apples and pears because different authorities measure different things according to their priorities. So I suppose, really, I just think it'd be good to have some comfort that there will be that encouragement for all those local authorities that are participating to actually agree some of the key data that they're looking at, so that we're not looking back in a couple of years' time and scrambling to try and find comparable data from across different local authorities.
I imagine that there will be desire from local authorities to learn from what other authorities are doing, to choose to take forward a visitor levy. Particularly authorities that are local to each other or share particular characteristics of their visitor economies. I think what's important with the reporting structure we've set out in legislation, and in fact it's for local authorities as a locally administered power to determine, is recognising that the visitor economy will be different in Edinburgh to what it is, say, in parts of the Highlands. And it allows for that local evaluation of the effectiveness of a visitor levy. And I say, these requirements around transparency with that separate accounting, the consultation, the reporting and the review will ensure that there's a fair and a thorough evaluation of how a scheme is operating, which will be transparent and available for all who are interested to engage with and consult with and to base their further engagement with a local authority on the visitor levy upon.
Thanks very much for that question, Stephanie. I think there is a point there, isn't there, around there must be some kind of, although there's nuance and need for local flexibility, there must be, you could probably get three things that could be in a framework that would for reporting on that would touch all local authorities and then have that flexibility around it. But I take your point around maybe this is maybe something that COSLA needs to be looking at rather than it being in legislation that the Parliament agrees on.
That would be it would be a matter for COSLA and local government. I certainly would imagine that it would be a recognition that we can all learn from each other, and local authorities will be keen to understand, if they're considering introducing a visitor levy, will be keen to understand what experience of other authorities have perhaps already introduced one. I think in terms of our interest would be, as a parliament, would be for parliament to determine, but I can imagine being able to respond to that aggregate feedback there'll be in terms of how the actual administrative framework that's provided for by the legislation is operating. And of course, in the medium to longer term, considering the broader national impact it would have upon Scotland's visitor economy. Mm-hmm. But these will be matters for Parliament to determine. Certainly in government, we will, subject to the legislation passed by Parliament, we will continue to engage closely through the new deal with local government on needs, matters and other shared priorities.
Great. Thank you very much for that. And I really appreciate you all coming in this morning. And Minister, thanks so much for your very thorough and in-depth responses. I do get a sense there's a few areas where we've kind of touched on questions where maybe there's a bit more work that needs to be done. And that would be interesting for us to consider in our report and reflect back to you. Yeah.
I'm very grateful for the extensive work that the committee's undertaken on this matter. And I do say with all sincerity, I'm very keen to understand what views the committee arrives at on some of these questions. As I say, my absolute priority is to ensure we get this right and that this visitor levy can be a real force for good for the visitor economy in those parts of Scotland which choose to introduce it. And I think key to achieving that will be continued close working and partnership with local government, with business and with Parliament.
That's very welcome. Thank you. So that concludes our evidence taking on the Visitor Levy Scotland Bill, and the committee will produce a report on its findings in the coming weeks. And I now suspend the meeting to allow for a changeover of witnesses. get my screen. Okay. The next item on our agenda today is to take evidence on the council tax freeze from the Minister for Community Wealth and Public Finance. And Mr. Arthur is joined in for this item by Ellen Lever, who's the Deputy Director of Local Government and Analytical Services Division. And I welcome our witnesses to the meeting. And we had also hoped to hear from COSLA on this topic, but unfortunately they were unable to attend today, and we hope to hear from it at a future meeting. Okay, we're just going to go straight to questions. And it was interesting, actually, because we did have COSLA online for the session earlier on the visitors' levy, and it was good to hear from Councillor Gail McGregor that that process had, in that process, there had been good communication between COSLA and the Scottish Government, and that they sound very positive about that. But what is interesting now is that local government wasn't made aware of the decision to freeze council tax prior to it being announced. And I'd be interested to hear from you your thoughts on how that's impacted the relationship between local government and central government.
Thank you very much, Convener. I'm grateful for the opportunity to answer questions on this issue. We recognise very much the views that have been expressed by local government since the First Minister's announcement on a council tax freeze. And both the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister have met and had engagement with COSLA since that announcement was made. What I would recognise is that the Verity House Agreement, which underpins our new deal with local government, is broad and wide-ranging. The fiscal element is just one part of that. Council tax is just one part of the fiscal element, and indeed the council tax freeze is just one part of our considerations around council tax. The committee will be aware of the work that has been undertaken through the joint working group on sources of local government funding and council tax reform. So we are committed to engaging constructively with local government colleagues in COSLA and to ensure that we are able to successfully implement a council tax freeze, which I think there's a shared understanding would be of benefit to households who are struggling right across Scotland.
Thanks very much for that response. And you mentioned the Verity House Agreement and the fact that fiscal arrangement is only part of it and council tax is only part of the fiscal arrangement. But I'd be interested to hear what your thoughts are in terms of the impact on trust. Are you confident that there's trust can be maintained now going forward between the local government and national government?
Yes, I am. As I said, we recognise the views that have been expressed by local government, but there is also a shared recognition of the opportunities that the partnership model that is embedded within the Verity House Agreement affords both local and national government in taking forward shared priorities, including in the area, for example, of council tax reform, which I know is of keen interest to this committee, Parliament more widely, and indeed COSLA and individual local authorities. So we are very much committed to that partnership working right across all aspects of the new deal with local government, and specifically with regards to council tax freeze, and ensuring we can implement this in a way that meets the requirements set by the First Minister of it being fully funded and delivers a freeze which will be of benefit to people across Scotland.
Thanks very much for those responses. I'm now going to bring in Pam Gosal.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the official. As you've mentioned, one of the primary principles of the Verity House Agreement has been violated less than 4 months after the agreement was made. A key part of the agreement centres around the robust and regular process for early budget engagement that will be embedded in the physical framework. However, the First Minister neglected to inform COSLA beforehand when he said during his speech at the SNP conference that council tax would be frozen for the upcoming year. So is this the Verity House Agreement even worth the paper it's written on? And if so, how is it failing to consult on the decision to freeze council tax in keeping with the principles of the actual agreement?
Well, as I said, I very much recognise the views and appreciate the concerns that have been expressed
both by you, Ms. Gosso, and indeed by colleagues in local government. We are committed to ensuring that specifically on the delivery of council tax reads, we do that in partnership with local government in these engagements we're really starting to take place. As I mentioned previously, the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister have both met with COSLA to discuss this matter specifically. As I touched on in an earlier answer, the Verity House Agreement, the new deal with local government, is significant and wide-ranging. There is, for example, on specifically fiscal matters, early engagement taking place in discussions around the budget, and there's a shared recognition that this presents a tremendous opportunity to advance what are our shared agenda and our shared priorities around ensuring we have sustainable public services, tackling net zero, and a fair and just transition to a net zero economy. So while I recognise the particular views that have been expressed and the concerns that have been raised, I'm confident that there's that shared ambition to deliver on the vision and the priorities that is set out within the Verity House Agreement, and we are certainly committed to taking it forward in that spirit.
Could I just come back in, please? Yeah. Minister, obviously you've explained the fact that this has happened, but how do we make sure that this never happens again? Is this something in a surety that the Minister or the First Minister or the Scottish Government is giving, that obviously this went ahead, the council tax freeze, without any consultation with any local authorities? And we have heard their views in here, but I've heard their views outside as well, that leaders and CEOs are not happy with local authorities, that basically this went ahead without their decision. And I understand, obviously, the thinking behind it, freezing council tax, but obviously what's so important is that relationship. So are you saying this is a one-off thing, it will never happen again, and the government is looking at that something like this never happens again?
I think we both would recognise there may be particular circumstances that can arise. However, we are jointly committed to the values underpin the Verity House Agreement, and that we want to operate and we want to work in a way jointly in partnership that is consistent with the approach that's set out within the Verity House Agreement, and that is how we will seek to go forward and to continue to build upon the progress that has already been made in short order since the agreement was reached.
Thanks very much for those responses. Continue. We're obviously very concerned about the relationship with local authorities, and I'd like to bring in Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning again, Minister. Tom, you mentioned that the measure that was announced, the council tax freeze, is just one part of a broader and a wider agreement within Verity House. So it's really to pick out what your views are about continuing developing discussions with COSLA on this. We know that they haven't set out their view yet as a body to us, and that's why they're not here today. But could you just develop a little bit about the conversations that's going on with COSLA? You mentioned the FM and DFM are in discussion with COSLA. So from your own perspective, how is that progressing in terms of the wider Verity House?
It's progressing. It's progressing constructively, and indeed as are the engagement in the pre-budget space as well. I think more broadly, the last session where we were considering the visitor levy bill is an excellent example of the partnership working that is taking place with local government, developing a proposition in response to what is a long-term ask from local government. We again touched on the cruise ship levy, which we have committed to. Again, this is a proposition that was raised by local government, and it is something we're responding to positively. And certainly in the areas that I lead on and have the direct responsibility in the relationship around aspects of local government finance, I'm committed to working in partnership with local government colleagues to look at the opportunities we have to further increase the fiscal empowerment of local government. And I think that is reflected not just in the visitor levy or in the cruise ship levy that we have committed to, but also in the work we've undertaken already on reform to aspects of council tax, for example, around the levying of a premium on second homes and the consultation that we undertook in that area as well. So we are making progress, and I know that my ministerial colleagues and other portfolios covering a wide range of areas could speak to where they have seen significant progress.
and through that partnership working approach. And that is something we are certainly committed to recognising the huge opportunities afforded to us by this approach of working in partnership and with mutual respect with our local government colleagues.
Thanks for that. We know that the freeze is bound to have an impact on the fiscal framework going ahead, but we know we won't see that before the budget. But has the government made any analysis, even at this early stage, about what the impact on the fiscal framework of the freeze might be?
Well, in terms of meeting that commitment of ensuring that the freeze is fully funded, we are engaging and will be engaging constructively with local government to determine what that quantum should be. And that is a process which will be ongoing. And, of course, decisions on the broader fiscal settlement will be taken as part of the budget process with the budget statement to Parliament next month.
Okay. Thanks very much for that. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much, Willie. And we're going to move on to a theme around the reason for the council tax freeze. And I'm going to bring in Stephanie Callaghan, who's joining us online.
Thanks very much, Convener. Thank you. I'm wondering, Minister, how you respond to those who say that the council tax freeze is regressive and that it doesn't benefit the poorest in society, and what you see as being the benefits of the council tax freeze?
Well, I think there's a shared recognition of the inherently regressive nature of council tax overall. A council tax freeze will benefit everyone who pays council tax, and we can understand that for those in lower incomes, it may well represent a higher proportion of their income as well. But I think all of us around this table would recognise, in our role as representatives in our respective constituencies and region, there is really no part of society, no part of the people we are elected to serve, who have not been touched in quite a significant way by the impact of the cost of living crisis. That's certainly something that's been reflected to me in conversations I've had with those working in advice and in money advice, for example. So I think the council tax freeze can give people certainty at a time when we have seen significant fiscal pressure arising from the cost of living. And it is a policy which I know will be welcomed by households across Scotland. It's providing that certainty going into the next financial year.
And I have to agree. And I have to agree, Minister. I think that certainty is really, really important for people. I'm wondering if you could speak to any lessons that have been learned from the last council tax freeze and how effective it was in tackling any inequalities, and any evidence that you have on this also. Thanks.
Well, we know that council tax in Scotland is significantly lower than it is in England, for example, and that is ultimately money that stays in people's pockets. It is money that people can use to meet other costs that fall upon them. It is money they have at their disposal to spend in their local communities supporting local businesses. So we recognise views around the need for looking at longer-term meaningful changes to the council tax system. But what this freeze does do in responding to the acute pressure that so many are facing in this cost of living crisis is, as I've said and has been acknowledged, provide that certainty. And of course, in terms of determining the quantum of meeting that council tax freeze, that will be undertaken through negotiation and engagement with COSLA.
Thank you.
Thanks very much for those responses, Minister. I'm going to bring in Miles Briggs around the theme of the powers to freeze council tax.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to ask, with regards to the powers Scottish Government have to do a full national freeze, because it appears the Scottish Government doesn't have the necessary powers. And just like previous freezes, that's been under Concordat with councils. So are you confident you'll be able to effect a council tax freeze across Scotland? And what else do you plan to bring forward to incentivise councils to buy into this?
We're seeking through working in partnership and engagement with local government to achieve a council tax freeze. And I think that is based as well on a shared recognition of the points I was touching on earlier. This is something that can have a meaningful impact to households right across Scotland. So the approach we are taking is one through negotiation and engagement, and that is something that will be ongoing. And it's through that particular process that we will seek to and will deliver, I'm confident, through partnership working with local authorities, that council tax freeze.
Currently, this year's council tax, I think, is an average of about 5.5% increase. Some councils were talking about 10% last year. Orkney, for example, set a 10% increase. It's quite clear that there are different councils with different financial pressures. My own here in Edinburgh, which receives one of the lowest funding per head of population. So just wondered, how would the government respond to a local authority who say no thanks and instead want to increase council tax? So in theory, there wouldn't be that national freeze delivered.
As I say, we recognise that local authorities have in previous years set council tax at different rates. They will have had their own planning assumptions ahead of the next financial year. That's why it's very important that we have this process of negotiation and engagement, and through that to arrive at a quantum that is fairly representative of what is required to meet that council tax freeze. So we are very much committed to working in that space closely and collaboratively to identify what an appropriate quantum should be, and through that to achieve the outcome of a council tax freeze for all households across Scotland.
And what would the maximum quantum look like? I think 5% would be £148 million, 8% would be £417 million. The government, 10% or 15%, where are the government in terms of what money will be on the table for this? Because I don't think it's been outlined how much we're actually talking the Scottish Government will fund this policy with.
Well, I would not want to preempt what the outcome of those negotiations would be. We are entering this in a process of a commitment to working and engaging closely and collaboratively, identify that, and we will have those discussions with our colleagues in local government to ensure that we can meet that requirement that this is fully funded. But as you touched on, we recognise there will be a range of planning assumptions that will have underpinned local government decisions around where they may have been wanting to go with council tax. So we will allow for that opportunity to take place of negotiation and engagement, and that is what will ultimately inform how we arrive at what is a fair and representative quantum to deliver that council tax freeze.
Okay. Thanks, Karina.
Thanks very much, Miles. I'm now going to bring in Pam Goodall.
Thank you, Convener. According to the calculations made by Fraser of Allender Institute, the freeze was collectively cost councils around about £148 million next year. Assuming council tax would have increased 5% as it did last year, additionally, councils would receive around £417 million if they were to strike a deal that gave them around 8% rise. Surely the Scottish Government has carried out some kind of analysis for making a commitment to fully fund the freeze. And so how much does the Scottish Government expect the council tax freeze cost? And more crucially, where will the money come from?
Well, as I said in response to Mr Briggs' questioning, we will have a process of careful and considered engagement in a spirit of partnership with local government to determine what the quantum will be, and I don't want to preempt that process. With regards to the resourcing of that particular quantum, decisions will be taken as part of the budget process, and the Deputy First Minister will set out the budget to Parliament in a statement next month.
To go back, yeah. I've got one more question around the First Minister giving commitment to fully fund the freeze to ensure councils can maintain their services. Despite offering no real clue as to where the money will come from, it is highly likely that different councils would have planned different increases in council tax in order to maintain services in their areas. So while the funds allocated to the local government take into account that various council tax hikes that each local authority has planned?
We will arrive at a position, as I've said, through engagement and consideration. Of course, we've committed to that engagement and those discussions,
And I think for me to seek to preempt what the outcome of them would be a committee would not be consistent with that commitment that we have given and we are committed to fulfilling. So to reiterate, we will have those discussions and engagement in a spirit of partnership with local government, and through that process we will seek to arrive at the quantum that is commensurate with that commitment to fully fund the council tax freeze.
Sorry, Minister, can I just ask the question that have you started talks with local authorities, or are you going to start talks with local authorities on what that quantum will be?
We are embarking upon that process, and as I indicated earlier, the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister both met and engaged with COSLA following the announcement of the council tax freeze.
Thank you.
Now we're going to go to Mark Griffin, who's joining us online.
Thanks, Convener. When opposition members like myself come to ask questions or maybe ask for additional budget, the first thing the Minister himself and other ministers will say, well, you need to identify where that funding is coming from. I just wonder what discussions the Minister and the Cabinet Secretary for Finance have had with other Cabinet colleagues to identify where the funding will come from to fund a potential council tax freeze.
The position and the determination of funding will be set out as part of the overall budget process that's considered in that particular context. What I would note as well, of course, is that we will carefully analyse what is announced next week in the autumn statement, which is a key to setting the envelopes that we will operate within, and of course the respective forecasts of the OBR and SFC, which again will set the context for which the fiscal environment that we operate within. But we have given that commitment. I've set out the process by which we will arrive at fully funding the council tax freeze. And in terms of the broader determinations around funding allocations, that will take place through the budget process, and the Deputy First Minister will set out that position to Parliament next month.
The Minister, you've just said that the council tax freeze will be fully funded, and that's a commitment that's come from the First Minister as well. What is your understanding of what a fully funded council tax freeze means?
Well, as I stated earlier, I would not want to preempt the outcome of the discussions and the negotiation that we have committed to with local government. So it's through that process that we will arrive at a quantum that will fully fund the council tax freeze. And as I stated previously, for me to seek to preempt that would be to disrespect that process.
I'm not asking you to put a figure on it. I'm just asking what your definition of a fully funded freeze will be. What does it mean for it to be fully funded?
Again, that's why we have committed to having that engagement with COSLA. If I were to give a definition without having engaged with COSLA and having had those discussions, I think that would be seen as presumptuous. So that's why we have committed to that process of engagement, which we will undertake, and that will provide a means by which we will arrive at determining what that quantum should be.
You can understand that one person's description of fully funded and another may be different. And so I find it difficult that you, Minister, can give a guarantee or a pledge that the council tax freeze will be fully funded. And the First Minister has given that pledge, but without being able to say what a fully funded freeze looks like.
That's why we require negotiation to...
OK, the First Minister has also said that the commitment to fully fund the freeze means that councils would be able to maintain the services. Now, obviously, finance planning would mean that councils are already planning which level of council tax they may have set in advance of this announcement. If the funding falls short of that and councils have to either reduce services or make redundancies, what would be the government's response to that?
Well, with regards to understanding what local authorities' planning assumptions were, That again is why we have committed to this process of negotiation, and it is through that we will arrive at a quantum which meets that commitment to fully fund the council tax freeze. I can appreciate the line of questioning that you're pursuing, Mr. Griffin, and I think it's a perfectly fair and valid one to seek to interrogate me as a minister on. However, I think it's very important that, having given this commitment to a council tax freeze that is fully funded and delivered in partnership with COSLA, it is important that that process is allowed to take place of negotiation and consideration.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much, Mark, and thanks, Minister, for bearing with us in the line of questioning. I'm going to bring in Marie McNair around long-term plans for council tax. Marie.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, looking forward to the longer term, how is the Scottish Government progressing in its ambitions to reform council tax?
We have already, I think, made meaningful progress. I read reference earlier to the consultation on council tax premiums for second homes, and that is a commitment we have jointly arrived at with COSLA. And brought forward the legislation, which I understand I think this committee will be considering in due course. So I think that is demonstrative of the progress that we have made to date. We continue to have engagement through the joint working group, in which we'll be exploring ways in which we can meaningfully make improvements to the council tax system, including looking at options for longer-term reform. As part of that, we have committed to a process of a deliberative engagement, and we recognise this as a shared priority with COSLA, and it will be a desire to further advance that work as we go into the new year.
Thanks for that. All the questions covered.
Marie, then that's good to get a little insight into what you're busy with in that regard. Well, that brings us to the end of our questions. So thanks again for being with us for two sessions this morning. It's been very helpful to get your views on the council tax freeze and the ongoing discussions with COSLA around this issue. Before we go into private, we have one final short piece of public business consideration of the non-domestic rate Contribution Scotland Amendment Regulations 2023. There's no requirement for the committee to make any recommendations on negative instruments. Do members have any comments on the instruments? No comments. Is the committee agreed that we do not wish to make any recommendations in relationship to the instrument? We're agreed. Thank you. We previously agreed to take the next items in private, so as that was the last public item on our agenda today, I now close the public part of the meeting.